Jesus had to go through. And then there's this unspeakable gratitude and joy because he did it for me and so that I could spend forever with him. We know the story doesn't end at the cross, right? We know he suffered. We know he died. We know he was buried. But we also know he rose again. Amen? The grave was no match for Jesus. And we get to share in that victory over death. But what kind of love? What kind of love is that? What kind of joy could he have possibly had to endure such torture and torment? The Bible tells us that he endured for the joy set before him, the joy that we would be able to spend forever with him, the joy that we could live in unhindered relationship with him. With all of this in mind, with this truth, with this gospel that we've been given, with this good news that we've been given, how are we to even respond? How do we respond to a love, to a God so holy? How do we respond to a love that's so relentless for us? Romans 12, verse 1 says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let your bodies be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." That word worship we'll have to dive into some other time. But let's look at that. Because of all God has done for you. Another translation says, "In view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice unto God." Let's sit there for just a moment. In view of God's mercy, in view of God's mercy, keeping in mind that God withheld his pure and righteous wrath from us, in view of the fact that it should have been us on that cross, in view of the fact that we hated him and he loved us anyway, in view of God's mercy, let us offer ourselves as living sacrifices unto God. You know, every time I read this verse and I see the phrase living sacrifice, I always automatically envision the burning bush in Exodus that God spoke to Moses through to commission him to go and rescue the Israelites out of Egypt. Really quickly, for anyone unfamiliar with that story or unfamiliar with this part of the story, Moses, he was born an Israelite, but he grew up in Pharaoh's house. He grew up in the king's house in Egypt, while the rest of the Israelites lived as slaves, okay? Well, one day, Moses killed one of the Egyptians, and Pharaoh, the king, he heard about it and wanted to kill Moses, so Moses fled. He ran away. He made a new life for himself in a new country until one day he came across a bush that was on fire, but it wasn't burning up. It wasn't withering. It wasn't being scorched, okay? And from that bush, God spoke to him. God revealed himself to Moses, and God sent Moses to go and rescue the rest of his people out of Egypt. So that's what I think of when I see this phrase, living sacrifice, being on fire but not being consumed, being on fire but still being able to be used. So what does that look like for us? To offer ourselves as living sacrifices unto God. In view of God's mercy, let us offer ourselves. In view of God's mercy, let us love God with all of our hearts, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, and love others as ourselves. In view of God's mercy, let us yield or let us submit ourselves to the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit in us and let him set us on fire for God. For God, the one who made us, the one who called us and purposed us, the one who saved us and transferred us from the kingdom of death and darkness to the kingdom of life and light. In view of God's mercy, let us be holy as our Father in heaven is holy. And I will say this too, that there is no in-between with God. There is no in-between with God. James chapter 4, starting in verse 4, it says this, "You adulterers, don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again, if you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. Do you think the scriptures have no meaning? They say that God is passionate, that the spirit he has placed within us should be faithful to him. And he gives grace generously. As the scriptures say, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you." That's another promise. "Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world." Revelation chapter 3 says this, "I know all the things you do, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish you were one or the other. But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, somewhere in the middle, I will spit you out of my mouth." Listen, God doesn't want half of you. He doesn't want most of you. He doesn't just want you on holidays and special events. No, he wants all of you. Now, that doesn't mean we won't fall sometimes. That doesn't mean we won't mess up on this road to sanctification and holiness. But we get back up, and we get back up with a heart posture of repentance, turned back towards the Lord, receiving his grace, receiving his forgiveness, and moving forward in faith and hope and love. But being on the fence with God is not going to work. I heard a saying once that says, God is on one side of the fence and Satan's on the other. But Satan owns the fence too. You see, we are either for God or we're against him. We're for the enemy. We are either with God or we are with the enemy. We are either children of God or we are children of the enemy. There is no in between. And Satan wants us, the church and the body of Christ, he wants us to believe that there is an in-between, that there's this huge gray area. He wants us as the bride of Christ. He wants us to believe that we can be betrothed to Christ, be engaged to him, and still messing around with the world and in our sin. He wants us to believe that a little white lie is not the same as a full-blown lie. He wants us to believe that it's okay to get high or drunk sometimes. He wants us to believe that having a second or third plate when we know we only really need the one isn't really all that bad. He wants us to believe, well, I'm still a Christian. I don't have to go to church. See, God has already given us every single thing that we need to become more and more like him, to follow him. Remember, we talked about Philippians 2:13. He gives us both the desire and the ability to do his will. All we have to do is yield and say yes to him. Why? Why should we say yes? Because of all God has done for us. Because of his mercy. Because he first loved us. Band, you can come on back up. Yeah. As the band comes up, there's an account in the Gospels, a story in the Gospels, where there are some men questioning Jesus about whether they should pay taxes or not. Jesus asked them, "Whose image or whose picture is on the money?" And they answered, "Caesar's." And so Jesus said, "Well, then give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God's." The point Jesus was making here is that we are all made in the image of God. That's what Genesis chapter 1 tells us. We are all made in the image of God, and therefore we belong to him. We owe him our lives. But then, to add on top of that, those of us who do personally profess Christ, we have been bought with a price. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 tells us, we were slaves to sin that were redeemed by the blood of the Lamb of God. How much more do we owe him? How much more do we belong to him? As we prepare to transition into this last song in a time of prayer, I want to encourage us, each and every one of you, to come. If you're someone that is on fire for God, I encourage you to come, because there's more of him for you. There's more that he wants to give you. There's more that he wants to show you. There's more that he wants to call you to. If you're someone that's been on fire for God, but that fire is getting a little dim, I encourage you to come. Get refilled by the Spirit of God again. If you're someone that's been on the fence and you're ready to say yes to God, come. Say yes to him. Say yes to him again. And if you're someone who's never said yes to Jesus, if you've never accepted Christ as your Lord, as your Savior, if you've never given your life to him, come. He's waiting and he's ready for you. There are several people in this room I know that would be willing to talk with you, willing to pray with you. I'm willing to talk with you. I'm willing to pray with you. I'm willing to dive into scripture about anything I've talked about this morning or anything that Holy Spirit may be laying on your heart. But God wants you to come. His invitation is always, always, always open. And that is what it is. It is an invitation. He's not going to force himself on you. This invitation has always been open to each and every one of us, and it will never, ever expire. It'll never expire. He's ready and waiting for a response. So as Joshua plays this last song, how will you respond today and to all that he's done for you? Our altars are open.
So before I actually start singing this song, I just want to thank the band for being willing to come back up. I had another song set up to play, and this one is brand new, and Holy Spirit just put it on my heart while Genesis was speaking. So thank you guys for still being willing to come up here and dealing with me. JJ, if I could just ask you to put on a pad in the key of D, and just keep that going.
You are more than able. 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 Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? And you are more than able. Yes, you are more than able. You are more than able. You are more than deny what the Lord can do.
This song is, we're just going to sit right there on the chorus. We're not doing anything else, but it's so simple, and it talks about that humility that Genesis was saying. We're either for God or we're against Him. And it's as simple as that. Am I going to be arrogant enough to deny what God can do? Or am I going to say, who am I to deny what the Lord can do and acknowledge that He is more than able?
So you are more than able. You are more than able. Oh, you are more than able. You are more than able. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Yes, you are more than able. God, you are more than able. God is more than able. God is more than able. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do?